And welcome to the Rock and Roll Survivors Podcast, dedicated to those in front of the curtain, behind the curtain, and somewhere in between. So let's get started.
The idea of a first, which we'll let go of, but a first all-female rock and roll band, right? To me, I was a kid, I was 3 years old, and you were all so inspiring to me. This is what women can do. Women can lift each other up. Women can become empowered. Women are there. We're family. I've got all my sisters in me. And to hear that you joining was not celebrated, but it instead was stigmatized and
later. Yes.
Later.
Yes.
But, well, I mean, later, but not that much later. As you were
no,
saying.
But not at the time. She couldn't say enough in the press.
No, but I'm talking about, you were saying, even Alice saying this, which doesn't make any sense to me.
Yeah, he quit.
And June quit. It's not like they were fired. It's not like you replaced them because they didn't want to leave.
And exactly.
The other thing I want to clarify is there is a very loud rumor, and I want to make sure that we clarify this. Am I right that the former members of the band didn't want you and Brie to be a part of the Fanny She Rocks Awards in 2008?
Yes, that happened. Let me get to that in a minute. That happened a little later, but there's an important thing that happened right here with these oral histories. With, you know, there's this nebulous time where a lot was going on. The band was done, you know, and all that. And then the album came out that Brie was doing with the two, Fanny Walked the Earth, you know, they made that. And there was a lot of stuff going on in and around that. As we sort of got reacquainted, came back together, there was the She Rocks Awards. There was the movie filming. So all of this was happening in this short couple year time period, okay?
This is around 2018.
A lot happened. And one of them blew my mind, okay? It had to do with Alice, you know, more malice. We were sitting, this was during the filming, I believe, or the album, you know, when Brie brought us in to sing and be part of the Fanny Walk the Earth album. She wanted us to be on one song. Mind you, I brought in, you know, I'm such a, you know, non-entity, but I brought in Genya and Kathy Valentine and Cherie to take part on it. And they contributed part to a song.
Genya Ravon and Cherie Curry.
Yes. And June didn't want me to play on that album. So I had to hear that first. Brie was like, no, we're going to do it. You know, they could take my connections and bring them in, but leave Patty out. Okay, so, well, that was real fun. You know, I sang anyway on it. Wendy was allowed to be on it. Alice came in and drummed, you know, but that's what happened.
Wendy Haas. So
that was hurtful. You know, just these things kept happening, like this erasing type of thing, you know. So we were sitting at the kitchen table.
Who's we?
Brie and me and Alice DeBure. And, you know, we'd already had some intimate talks, getting, you know, trying to just move past the past and youth and all the stuff. You know, I'm a very forgiving person. I was, you know, okay, we're coming together to do these certain projects and move forward. You know, that's me. Alice sat at the table, I'll never forget this, and looked at me and said a formal apology. She said, you know, I really regret leaving the band. I shouldn't have left. I should have played with you. It wasn't about you, which blew my mind. I was in shock right there. She said it was about me not being able to confront June. I was so angry at June. There was my band breaking up and June leaving, and I couldn't confront her. And she was admitting this to me, saying, and I threw all the shade at you. And we had it out. I said, you know, I was a guitar player. You know, she said, well, June was my guitarist and blah, blah, blah. And I liked her style. And, you know, I just decided I threw it at you, you know, and it was in her youth. She did that. That's what she chose to do. And it was true about the girlfriend giving an ultimatum. She said, all of that happened. But the real reason I threw it at you was because I couldn't confront June. And then she said, yeah, I made a mistake. I should have stayed. It's one of my big regrets. So, of course, that made me feel better in that moment in time. This is years later, you know, in wisdom, you know. So that felt pretty good, trying to bury the hatchet and whatever. And then she added one thing in. She said, you know, I got to go back to that Tanya oral history, the one that the Tanya was her name, did, and correct some of that shade. And I said, yes, that would be real nice if you would do that. You know, I agreed. And P.S., years later, never happened.
How does that make you feel?
Well, more happened. So, you know, I knew that at that point, as things kept happening during this time of projects, I knew that I had to keep a scorecard here, like, geez, are they going to keep doing this? You know, the back and forth. Talk out one side of the mouth, than the other. It felt horrible because I wanted to be all good with it all. And let's move forward. These fabulous projects are happening. Let's monetize it. Let's make the most of it. All six of us, minus Fanny, minus Nikki, five of us, we're going to be able to play together for the first time on stage after 50 years. You know, it was like a good thing. So the fact that some other, you know, incidents kept happening was heartbreaking for me, heartbreaking. And I just kept pushing it inward, pushing it in, and just dealing with it. Okay? It was very hard, very hard.
Not only hard, that is the farthest thing from magic and creating music.
It was. And then another one happened with Nikki, you know, that I'll revert back to about Nikki. That really was heartbreaking to me. You don't, Jean, in her oral history, had alluded to the fact that Nikki had mental issues. However she worded it, she used the word mental issues, right? Okay. And I was like, how do you do that? How do you take someone in older age and demean them like that and put that out there in public, like she was a mental case? And yet, you were the one that decided to keep working with her. It's number one, it's contradictory. It makes you look foolish. You know, why would you continue with Nikki if she was such a mental case? And for me, it was so cruel to do that.
That's very cruel.
To Nikki, very cruel to encapsulate Nikki that way. Now, I will say, you know, I look at this too in the magic sphere of how things go. You know, I know my own brother. I mean, I know a lot of you, your dad, you know, different people we come across, artists and musicians. There's a lot of brilliant, crazy, gifted talents out there. And they sort of walk that edge of brilliant and crazy. And they might have a certain bent to them, you know, a certain humor, a certain sarcasm and everything. But they're functioning. They're producing music. They're producing magic, in my opinion. They're just, you know, framed a different way in their own psychology. So why tear someone a new asshole like that? Why? You know, why would you do that? It's just so cruel and unnecessary. That one really bothered me almost more than the Alice one, because I didn't feel Nikki deserved that in retrospect, to take her into that realm of being mental.
Well,
come on. And she said stories. She put out some stories about it to prove it, which made it worse. You know, I'm sure Nikki, if she had a rebuttal, she could have told a lot of stories of where things happened with June or Alice or her, you know, and said a lot too.
Well, I think that that is such an excellent point, which is if Nikki could give a rebuttal. Nikki could not, is not in the public eye anymore. She's been out of the public eye far longer than when that interview was done. So to refer to you as adequate is, like you said, I mean, that's awful, but fine, that's her opinion. But to say about somebody that they're mental, that implies a certain caliber of a diagnosis that And Nikki doesn't get to say anything back. It's just very unfair, and it's very cruel, I think.
It's so wrong. It's so wrong. And then another one happened around the She-Rocks thing. That was interesting, too. Again, I must qualify, I didn't know June, and we'd had some great intimate talks up to this point, okay? And then She-Rocks came up, and it was supposed to be on Fanny Walk the Earth, and the owner of She-Rocks, you know, the head lady, very nice lady, she was going to put them in for an award, an inspiration award and all that. And it came to point through discussion that, well, you know, include the Fanny, the original Fanny. And then Brie got to thinking, well, you know, then you have to do all six, you know. I mean, Patty came in, brought people to the Fanny Walk the Earth one, and she sang on it. And, you know, she was the fifth album. My God, you know, how can you do Brie and not Patty, you know? So there were talks and stuff, and Brie pushed it, and she was very communicative with me, saying, you know, I want you in this. It should be all of us celebrating womanhood and band music, you know, again, the magic, you know, bring it in, you know, don't separate it, not even to Fanny Walk the Earth and leaving the originals out or the fifth album, just do it. Because then you have the demographic of my name, my involvement, the early girls and their involvement and what they did, you have it all, you know?
There's a very different narrative by saying we're honoring Fanny. And these band members include former bands like The Pleasure Seekers, Cradle, The Svelts, Wild Honey.
Yes.
That would be such an incredible narrative because it would highlight your all of your legacies and what all of you accomplished, not only separately, but together. And then together again 50 years later. It's
exactly, exactly. So Brie had the right idea, okay? And June, she was not on board. The head lady said that's what it was going to be. She made a decision. She thought about it and thought, you know, that's right. That's what it should be. It makes it more exciting even, you know? So that the decision was made, and there happened a phone call between June and me, and we had to go to the woodshed and talk about our feelings about it. She felt that I shouldn't be in there at all. And, you know, said so very, that was her truth. And I told her what I thought, you know, about, you know, it's, what are you talking about? You know, I was on the fifth album. I was in Fanny Walk the Earth. You were in the original. It should be celebrating everything. Exactly what you just said, you know, so much more exciting. So we had it out. And in the end, June had to agree. You know, she had to let it go at some point because the head girl had made the decision. And that was that. So that's what we did. And honestly, to be fair, we had a wonderful time at it. We all handled each other with respect. We all said our little piece on the mic, and it was a wonderful award and a magical evening. It went very well, you know, and people loved it. So there you go. And then it started into the filming and all that stuff. And there were more stuff that happened. We got the LA mini tour.
Just for those that don't know, you're talking about the Fanny documentary.
The Fanny documentary. Yep.
The LA tour, which was, it's a 50th anniversary where all of you are coming together.
Big deal. A big deal. And let me, I really have to make it clear that this is all inner feelings. After so many, Kristen, so many intimate talks happened during that tour and before, okay? And still behaviors happened, which were heartbreaking to me, okay? We did the tour. I had long talks with Alice. I had had long talks with Jean and June and all of us, different configurations. You know, you'd be in the hotel, you'd go to dinner. And you really talked through about the music biz and all this stuff. It all got discussed. But then things would still happen. Before the tour, when we were discussing the songs and the set list, I was told that June had to go to an astrologer to get permission to do one of my songs in the set. That was the biggie. That really hit me, you know. I couldn't believe it.
I'm speechless.
I was speechless.
Yes, I'm speechless on this. But just to clarify, June didn't want had to consult an astrologer to say yes to play one of your songs, which was on the fifth Fanny album. This is not Patty Quatro song from Pleasure Seekers.
Yes, and I thought it was a, and I believe that even that song had been on the B-side on different releases of Fanny, and it was a popular song, and it was a good crowd rouse, you know, it was a good one, real upbeat and fun, Jungle Rock Star. And I mean, this went on, and I knew about it. And again, there I am in the middle of this heartwarming 50th thing, you know, we're putting it together, and I hear these asides, and I have to deal with the heartbreak and push it down, you know, push it down, just don't even attach to it, because I want to be in the magic of it. That's me. So that was heartbreaking. And these kinds of things have gone on, you know, to lump it all together, they keep going on. You know, when you see the site, it's the four. That's never including Brie and I, you know, the induct site and just different things, you know, little things that come back at me, you know, that I hear went on. There was a lot of it, you know, the trying to erase it, the point one, the point two. Another one that really got me crazy was the LA All-Stars one. She called it Fanny Point Three, you know. They were never Fanny. They never recorded. They picked Nikki's song, oddly, and Butterboy. And it was co-opted to be called Gene's hit song, Butterboy.
Butterboy.
And honestly, Nikki had a part in writing that. Nikki was so gracious. She just let Nikki, you know, let Gene carry it. But Nikki put in a lot of words. All you have to do is listen to the words. And you know that, you know. So Nikki was gracious that way. So, you know, there again...
I need to interrupt for a second because you just said something that I think is, well, you've said it, but I think it's really, it bears talking about. There is this intentional erasure, this narrative that's being pushed about you specifically. They can't necessarily push Brie out entirely because she has too long of a history with them in terms of since they were teenagers.
That's true.
There is an intentionality to their cruelty to you. And the thing that I don't understand is why.
Oh, I understand it.
So let me hear it. Tell me why, because it's, I keep using the word disappointing, but it's so disappointing to hear. I've had my own experiences with many people in the music biz, including the people we're talking about. So I'm not surprised. I've had my own experiences as well. But for you specifically, because I hate that you've had to keep pushing it down and squashing it and having to keep just taking all of this. And as you said, it is going coming out both sides of the mouth. And, you know, one of the things that I've learned, I'm almost 57, is, you know, that old adage, with age comes wisdom. Well, that's not true necessarily.
No. When that people tell you who they are, believe it.
Absolutely.
Believe it. And I'm a Pollyanna. I'm telling you, that is my nickname. I'm a Pollyanna. I will stay in the light and try to just go on, you know, and push it away. That's not how I roll. So I understood what is going on. I do understand it to this day. There is, you know, in the malice part of it, there's hunger, there's envy, there's jealousy, there's overprotectiveness. I mean, you have two of them that left the band on their own, you know, that was a magical 4 years of their life. I get it. I get it. They work their balls off to try to break it through. And they have a protectiveness thing, but it's an overprotectiveness to the point of being demeaning and dismissive. I call it the three Ds, the dissing, demeaning, and dismissiveness, you know? And that's part of the element of LA that I hated. And that went on through decades against me, and some of it against Brie, even. She suffered some of it. And, you know, Brie just pushes it aside too. You know, she's strong that way. But the hunger to make yourself stay relevant, and these are the 4 years that have to be encapsulated. You know, I mean, that's it. That was Fanny, you know, and just erase the fifth album. No, you don't do that with a legacy. You know, it killed me. It just, It killed me, but I had to keep pushing it aside. To this day, it's still hurtful. And we all, in saying that, my Pollyanna, I still get along. I still talk with them. I still, you know, we had such good talks about all of this. And then another thing would come up. And I would be like, huh? Huh? Still? It just, yeah.
Well, that is heartbreaking. And I'm just, I think to go back to what we, our magic and malice pillars that we've been talking about.
Yeah.
I'm protective of you, my dear. And I don't like the fact that you left this magic and landed in malice. But you are such a Pollyanna and you are so talented, but you're also wicked smart. And you see things in a much larger way. And you can you can have empathy for people. And I think, as you talked about with some people in the music biz, whoever you are, whether it doesn't have to even be LA, right? But there sometimes that hunger does override any other
yes
fluidity and acceptance of a larger narrative or a history or an inclusivity to it. And I just don't understand it. I mean, being the daughter of your manager, Roy Silver, there's a couple things that he said that I'm thinking of right now. One he said was, you never know who somebody is. You treat that secretary as well as you treat the CEO of a company, because you never know. You don't know that she's not the daughter of somebody, da da da. You don't know that she doesn't have her own ambition. So you just never know. Treat everybody equally. And I think that that also speaks to the other thing that he said. And he said this to me when I was a kid. Mm-hmm. So I'll set up for context here. This was when my dad was running his restaurant called Roy's. And it was the place to be seen as your brother who all the time, every celebrity and star was there. And my dad would call me and say, I'm making this up, you know, the Bee Gees are coming in tonight, because he would see who was coming in. And I can't remember which celebrity it was, but there was somebody in there where I lost it. I was so starstruck. And my dad pulled me aside and he said, there are two types of people in this world. And I'm about to cuss people. So if you don't want to hear me cuss, cover your ears. There are two types of people in this world. There are stars and there are star fuckers. And he said, don't be a star fucker. And what he meant by that, well, there was a couple things. Obviously, what he meant was, don't be a star fucker. Don't fawn over these people, right? You can be a star and you can admire these people, but they're not better than you. And don't give them that. But the other thing that I thought was so powerful within that expression of, you know, there are stars and star fuckers, don't be a star fucker, is there's a choice. And I think in a way, it's like what you were talking about with your worldview of being a Pollyanna, that's a choice. Yeah. You could have been really bitter. You could be incredibly bitter and it would be understandable. And it would be absolutely, you can own that, but you're not like that. And that's a choice. And so, and that's to me, the difference when you're talking about being a star or a star fucker, stars are also not necessarily hungry. And they're not going to only go after other people that they think they can get something from.
Yeah.
And you can't, the idea of what my dad was trying to teach me is, don't discard people because you think they can't give you something, but also know your worth and don't ever think anybody's better than you.
Absolutely. And I'll add something to that. You know, Anita Strauss, amazing phenomenon, female guitarist nowadays, a friend of mine, you know, we've met and everything and had some discussions. And I mean, I'm the old one, she's the new amazing one. She says, and I love this quote, ego kills talent. And hunger can be so ugly. It makes you do things, actions, and say things that you maybe would think better of if you just tamp down that hunger. You know, I wouldn't let the veneer of malice in LA get into my psyche. I wanted to be in the magic of Detroit. I have my whole life. And I won't change from that. I just won't do it. And you know what? You don't let somebody else, stars and star fuckers. I mean, we all have people we admire, you know, that we go gaga, oh my God, I love. But that's a different thing, you know? That's like envy versus jealousy. You know, you envy that person, you would love to be like them, have that success, but you don't begrudge them it. That's the ugly side, when you begrudge someone else. And a lot of that, I think, filters in to what I experienced in LA, that too. And you never let someone diminish your glow. You live your own life and you don't let, that's all I can do. Live in the magic, enough said, you know? Come on, do the music.
I just want to pick up on that. And then I want to talk a little bit more about where we're heading with season three and all of that. You know, it's one thing, as you said, the difference between envy versus jealousy or begrudging. In this particular case, the thing that hurts me so much for you and also for the larger history of women in rock is this idea of begrudging almost sounds simplistic. This has been an active pursuit of eradicating your time in a band.
Yeah. Well, I don't think they would ever say that or admit to it, but some of the actions and things that have been said points to that direction. You know, I'm not stupid. You know, that's what it felt like as these different things kept happening. So I just, you know, again, we talk today. I mean, we're fine, but that is there. It's there at the bottom. And I just push it aside. What else can I do? I don't want to, you know, mess up the projects that we've done and the, you know, all the good stuff that have come from the film and whatever we've done, the legacies and stuff. We're getting ready to reissue the Rock and Roll Survivors album. So, you know, there's a lot still going on. I'm just going to stay in the light, Kristen. And I can't live any other way. It just, it doesn't work for me. It doesn't work.
Well, clearly you and I are simpatico on that and so many things, because that was the reason that I wanted to do the Rock and Roll Survivors podcast, was because I'm an inclusive historian. And there initially this was going to be, I mean, of course, the name Rock and Roll Survivors podcast comes from the Fifth Fanny album, but I also think it's a more inclusive title because we can bring in other rock and roll survivors like your family. I'm hoping we'll talk to Addie Lee at some point in our conversations. But as I said before, you're my podcast partner in crime now. And as we are leaving season one and season two, I just want to round this conversation out by saying your magic in Detroit, your musical magic in Detroit, has been so inspiring for me as somebody who grew up in the Malice music business in LA, because it's such a difference. It's such an eye-opener. I have started to lose, I mean, let's not be dramatic here, but the cynicism of the music biz and people in it has started to crackle, thaw a little bit, because I so appreciate what you have done, what your sisters have done, what your brother has done, what your dad did. And then, and realizing that these are only a few, couple of players that you and I have been talking about. It's not everyone.
No, but it's not.
But it certainly is, to quote Hunter S. Thompson, there's definitely
a negative side.
A negative side. But I want to, as we're gearing up, season three is going to be talking about all of your incredible songs and performances with the Pleasure Seekers and Cradle and that history. I mean, we tease the listeners on season one, and I believe season two, that you could just basically read all the concerts and all your homeboys that you played with, like the MC5 and Ted Nugent and the Amboy Dukes, all these incredible. I just can't wait to get to it. But you were talking about Nita Strauss, right? And talking about leaving your ego. You have shared, and I want you to share with the listeners as we're saying goodbye, and I know you have some thoughts as well. Talk to me or tell us about what it was like, and first tell the audience who France Gall is, and how different that was from your, so first of all, now we're moving from the magic of Detroit to the malice of LA to what the glittering wonderfulness of Paris. So,
God. I'm telling you, you just brought it right back to me. There you go. You know, what I experienced in Detroit and then the stuff that happened in LA and then landing in Paris, we got picked, us women. Colleen Stewart was on that gig with me. They searched this French pop star, Franz, And her husband, Michel, they're well-known, beloved in Europe, recording artists. And they searched all over the world for what they could find to be the top musicians to form an all-female orchestra. Let me tell you, there was not one smidgen of drama with all these female musicians coming together with their egos and their psychologies. We loved it. We appreciated, we respected, we loved playing with each other. It was magic. And they treated us phenomenally. So, there I was back to the magic, and I loved it. We had a live album that was produced. We played the Théâtre des Champs-Élysées. It's a historical theater. We toured all over, and the girls were so talented. So talented. No hunger, no envy, no demeaning, nothing. That's back to it. And I had the same thing when I did other projects after Fanny, when I worked with Addie Lee. We did the Nylons. We did New World's Record with ELO. We had a great time. I never had any of this with Addie. She was fantastic, And other women in LA, Peggy Foster, who had played with the Runaways, and different ones. We all had a ball, different projects after Fanny. There was the magic. So I had some magic in LA, quite a bit, working with different types of females. It was wonderful.
Well, I love hearing that. And we are now going to be circling back to the land of magic for season three, getting back to your Detroit roots. I'm now an unofficial Detroiter.
You are. Yes,
what is your line, or what is the Detroit line? You either love Detroit or you're wrong.
Well, I'll say a couple last things about Detroit. I mean, I can't wait to get there. Take me back. My soul never leaves. Detroit was and is, it's rock and roll, it's soul. It's the whole idea of being cool. If you have to explain it to someone, they won't understand it because you didn't live it. You have to see it, live it, be it. And that's when Detroit starts to move you with the magic. It always has the foot on the gas, full throttle. That's the magic of Detroit.
Oh, I love that. I love that. Well, season three will be happening soon. I can't wait. Your brother Mickey will be coming back. I'm going to tease and say we have some other family members who we hope will be joining us very, very soon. And in the meantime, Patty, this was an amazing conversation. And here's to looking forward, more podcasts, more Rock and Roll Survivors projects, and so much more coming. So here's to more magic.
You got it. Let's go sneak up on it.